thank you so much. I appreciate the introduction and getting us off on the right foot here. I want to welcome everyone and thank you for attending this webinar. The focus of this session is to explore the challenges often found in all projects, but always found in complex projects, and such as projects that include activities that are in different life cycle phases, research and development, operations, or that have many subcontractors or partners, or have very diverse stakeholders, or any other combination of those that make for complex projects. These challenges really sum up to your ability to manage the overall project to successful conclusion. And so I really hope that you find the material presented here to be useful and applicable to your project. I'll try to make it very much so by giving you some models and some ways to think about things. And I really do encourage you to think through a project of your own as we go through this and try to put it in context for yourself so you can make the most out of the learning. So, hold on here.
If you click in the center of the screen, it should then allow you to use the space further.
Got it. Thank you. Thank you. So, some of the key factors that you're going to consider in the application of multiple project management methods within a project we're going to be reviewed during this webinar. For ease of communicating these concepts, I'm going to refer to product-focused projects. Although be aware that service or process related projects can also be addressed by these methods. And you know, for example, a project of that type might be the redesign of a workflow or a queue, the development of a new technique, which can also be projects. But just for ease of communication, I'm going to refer to product projects. So the first topic of discussion is under what circumstance do you really need to apply multiple lifecycle methods, and when does that become a need? So you may be used to determining that you're only going to use Agile for your project, or you're only going to use a traditional method, or any of the number of other project management methods that are available, and I will refer to them in a bit. But you know, I want to make sure that we think about this in terms of a complex project where you might need to apply multiple methods. So in complex projects, for example, one might find that you have project deliverables that span research development, early development, full production, or that just require the purchase and procurement of fully developed products, any combination thereof. Most projects have this these different types of activities going on. Then we're going to explore the topic of project volatility, or the level of expected change within the project throughout its life cycle, and that's going to help you also understand why you need to think about different methodologies within your overall project to increase your chance of success and minimize your risk. We'll also review techniques used to establish what I call trajectories and baselines, and that is what you will use in both research and development and in traditional projects where you're measuring your change against something. And if you're used to traditional project management methods, you're used to baselines. If you're used to Agile, you're going to be looking at your sprints and that type of thing. So we'll talk about the techniques used to establish those so that you can measure change, and then how that looks in the greater project when you're trying to manage it from an integrated perspective. And then we're going to discuss measurements that can be applied, and then governance activities associated with managing change in this sort of multidimensional environment where you have multiple project management methods being used. And then finally, we're going to talk about execution and strategies that will help ensure successful change management and execution of a project in this format. So let's start now with the focus on project life cycle. So a life cycle, when I refer to a life cycle, I'm talking about an end-to-end or systemic view of how an activity evolves over time. And it can be, you know, this life cycle view can be used to facilitate your decisions on when you want to invest in new technology that will replace or rejuvenate existing capability. Typically, a life cycle has phases that provide structure and focus. And so I've got a couple of models here that I like to use. The diagram on the left demonstrates a sort of a strategic view of initiatives or portfolio of activities. And within that portfolio, you will see on the left-hand model a program, a project, some strategic R&D activities. And in this particular example, the program also has elements of a project to incrementally improve an operations process. It's got an upgrade project that is utilizing both traditional and agile project management, and it also has some R&D, research and development, inclusive of basic research and spiral development. So from this perspective, we're seeing the life cycle as a cumulative view of all activities from the earliest R&D phase to operations upgrade. And this is a good way to start thinking about your project and how what you have in the way of your project that you have to execute and how you might think about applying different methods within the overarching project. So on the right side diagram, this is a model that helps you assess where a project or elements of a project might fall and the technical challenges and expected performance timeframes that would likely be affected during that. So for example, a project with significant technical challenges with an expected longer performance time frame would likely include elements that departed from your existing capability and maybe were inclusive of some R&D or some early development. And sort of having a background on the structure surrounding the activity and a perspective on what is driving your initiatives or the different parts of your project and what outcomes you really want from that activity, that's going to help provide the context for your overarching project structure as well as the project management methods that you have decided to go with. So to put this in perspective, I want to challenge you to think about a project that you're currently working on or have worked on in the past. And what product deliverables or service deliverables came from that? If you are familiar with work breakdown structures or work packages, that's going to help. But in essence, if you think about each unique element or activity that ends in a work product, that's going to help you. I like to use an example of a wind turbine, since most people can conceptualize what that looks like. So each work product in a wind turbine may be aligned with a different life cycle phase, and this is a good example to use. So for example, the structure, the main shaft, the mainframe, the tower, and the cell housing, that type of thing, may be production quality and require only purchase or procurement. And the rotor, you know, on the other side, the rotor assembly may require research and development or early development on the blades, the hub, the bearings. And then, of course, the electronics and software may also require modification and could therefore actually fall more into the research and development phase. And you're going to want to manage those not all with one methodology. You're going to want to make sure that you have the methodology that actually will optimize your performance and really increase your potential for success in those areas. So knowing that information is really essential to understanding the best options for managing that particular part of the project. I do want you to keep in mind though that the overall project, as an integrated whole, typically has a defined scope, a schedule, and a budget. Typically, for all of the activities, and they all must fit in regardless